the skills that they look for from our students, and it has to be looked at in the more long term. What are the skills that we need in students that will help the world of work, not just now but into the future? And clearly when employers are asked about that, they say that what they want students to do is to be able to solve problems, to be able to work in teams, to be able to use initiative. And these are skills that you can develop across a range of disciplines, across a range of university courses. They're not specific to any one course. So I would say that parents and young people themselves want to try to make sure that their young people are given the skills that will help them to fit somehow into society, so that they can see that they have a future and that they have hope for the future. We should take the long view and remember that, in a sense, it isn't that we have the answers, but we certainly have the questions. So our role as questioners, as people who help students to develop a critical sense, to work out who they should trust, who they should not trust, what they should trust, sources that they shouldn't trust, and to give a kind of a rich and depth to their experience as human beings. The whole, emergence of discussions around teaching and learning over the last 10, 20 years maybe, coming, in my experience, particularly from North America, from powerhouses like Harvard with Derek Bok, who was a lawyer but also president of Harvard and passionate about education, people like Frank Rhodes in Cornell and so on, people like Drew Faust, current president of Harvard. I think all of these people, to me, are inspiring, and our generation really, I suppose, that who launched the whole discussion around teaching and learning in our institutions. So I suppose if I would see recent developments that could begin to cope with the diversity of the student population who are coming to university now in greater numbers and in greater diversity than ever before, I would say really that we have to step back and look at our interactions with these groups. How do they learn? That's the big question. But we know so much more now about how people learn in terms of developments in neuroscience and so on. So that should be at the heart of our questioning. And to what extent is it? I'm not sure that it is. We talk about teaching practice, and we talk about information technology and distance learning. These are all incredibly important, but we talk about those as if they were solutions to a problem. For me, it's much deeper than that. We need to know how these diverse groups learn. We need to connect far more with the secondary schools, with primary schools. There needs to be far more of a continuum all the way through the education system, and also into lifelong learning. The idea that if you're a sentient human being, you're somebody who learns all the way through, it never stops. If you said we're going to put these young people at the centre of everything we do, well, then everything else would flow from that. Your funding model would change. Who teaches what would change. A very small instance, this is something that I am very, very passionate about, but I feel that younger students should get the star teachers. Very often the star teachers are regarded as so precious that you reserve them for the elite. I would turn that on its head. And I would say, for as long as you can, just to take the third level sector, in first year and maybe in second year, you put a maximum of resources, you put your star teachers, you put your most imaginative thinkers into that group. And you try to keep that going for a year, maybe 2 years. Now, I know it could be expensive, but then after that, the students should be self-starting. They should have enough confidence to know where they're going, what they're doing. In Ireland, the universities have a great deal of autonomy. So when I speak very often with my French friends, because the two systems I know best are the Irish system and the French system, I am surprised at how little autonomy they seem to have in very, very practical everyday areas. And they are astonished at the level of autonomy that I seem to have. Now, I'm not saying one system is better than the other at all, but I'm saying that, say, in the system that I teach in, or that I taught in until relatively recently, if I want to set up a new course, I want to set up a new program, I decide I won't have an end of year exam anymore, it will be 100% work of the year, continuous assessment. I tell my head of department, I tell the external examiner, but yeah, I can do that. I can start next September a very different system. When I say I can teach in the evening, I can bring in, if somebody is in Cork who is interesting, who could be interesting for my students, I say, please, you know, could you come talk to my students? When I mention this to my friends in France, they don't seem to have the same level of very everyday autonomy maybe at some abstract level, autonomy exists, but in your everyday practice, I think you have to trust people you have appointed to do a good job. You looked at their qualifications, you interviewed them, so why not trust them? And trust the students to do continuous assessment as well. I think symbols are very, very powerful. So here we are at the centre of the Quartier Latin in the Sorbonne, people coming from not just all over Europe but elsewhere here, and we're talking about a learning and teaching dialogue that's going on over 2 days. And the presence of, for example, the minister later on today, the presence of university presidents and so on, these are very busy people and they've come and they're taking time out of an agenda to be here and to support that. I think the symbolism is very, very important. So at that level, I'm very grateful to the EUA for launching that. I understand there will be another forum like this in 2 years' time, so clearly this isn't a once-off opportunity for everybody. It's going to be part of a process. So if the EUA could somehow be the driver in that area, I think it would be absolutely enormously important, because it doesn't exist at the moment.